Hello and welcome to the first edition of The Big Picture in the new year. And a very happy and fulfilling new year to all of you. The study of humanities in this country has never been more ignored and neglected as what we are witnessing now. As education, especially higher education, gets more and more privatized, it has been observed that courses in humanities are offered less and less. In out of the 113 private universities at the last count in this country, a handful offer courses in humanities, and even those who offer it are mostly at the undergraduate level. On the other hand, except in some of the top state and central run universities, less and less students are preferring to take up courses in humanities at the graduate and postgraduate level. It is said that an advanced civilization must give full value and support to branches of scholarly and cultural activity to achieve a better understanding of the past, better analysis of the present, and better view of the future. How is this crisis in the humanities education affecting us as a people and society? How to rescue humanities education and blend it with science, technology, and management education, among others? We will discuss all this with an eminent panel of guests, Professor Pushpesh Pant, a social analyst and commentator and former professor at the JNU, Professor Zoya Hasan, Dean of Social Science and Professor of Political Science at the JNU. We'll be soon joined by other guests also. Welcome to all of you, Professor Pushpesh Pant. Do you agree that there is a crisis in humanities education?
There's no question of disagreeing. I think humanities haven't had a sadder day. And I think it's not only a question of having a crisis in humanities. I think the problem arises because we have ceased to be humane. We don't seem to have any concern for humane values. We don't have humanism in our public life. And I think that's the reason why humanities are neglected. We only are worried about saleable skills. And when the Prime Minister is an economist, and it's a dismal science, it is not part of the humanities. And it's interesting that we try to aspire, all of us who studied humanities aspire to be social scientists.
Right.
So sociology, political science are in a twilight zone where they are social sciences.
Right.
And only if you are very old-fashioned, you would say there is a humanistic interface.
Yeah.
The problem is that what happens to literature? I mean, there was art side, there was science, and there was commerce.
Right.
And then there was this age of interdisciplinary thing. I think somewhere we lost touch with reality, and the chickens are coming home to roost. So we have so much concern about teaching values to people, so they should not be lumpens, they should not be crimes against women, there should not be lawlessness, there should be some respect for rule of law, there should be some sense of values in community and society. And this is what I think the humanities did. And the humanities was a value-based, not objective education all the time. And I think the problem is that we threw the baby with the bathwater.
Threw the baby with the bathwater. Professor Zoya Hasan, I'm sure you agree that there is a crisis in humanities education. And saleable skills, what Professor Pant says, saleable skills are what people are looking for, and not just knowledge as knowledge.
Well, I won't say that there's a crisis in humanities and social sciences. Humanities and social sciences as academic disciplines are doing well. The crisis has to do with the declining importance of humanities and social sciences. And I think this has to do with globalization. This has to develop, has to do with the market. This has to do with privatization. So the whole focus now is on useful education, education which will help you to get jobs. But my point is that humanities and social sciences are important in themselves, and they're also important. They provide you with important skills for jobs as well. For example, if you do an undergraduate or a graduate degree in the social sciences, it's not as though there are simply no job opportunities. But I think the important point is what you said in the beginning, in your introductory remarks,
right,
that humanities and social sciences are essential for any society. It's essential for the development of knowledge. It's essential for the understanding of the arts, for understanding the past, for understanding contemporary history. Above all, humanities and social sciences provides the very foundation of human civilization and understanding humanity. I think humanities help us in developing humane humane values and humane people.
Professor Pant, human values, human people, all this fine. And you made, both of you are making one significant point. Can we link it to this process of liberalization, globalization, which has happened? And I don't think this crisis which we're talking about, humanities, is just, you know, is central only to India. It is, you know, we are hearing this kind of debate happening in the US, in the West also.
No, I think the point which Professor Zoya Hasan is making is an interesting one. I mean, she's repeatedly referring to humanities and social sciences.
Right.
And I think the moment you make a distinction that there are humanities and there are social sciences, there is an undervaluation of humanities in any case. Now, if you are a social scientist, you are halfway there in the scientific business.
Right.
Your discipline is more rigorous.
Rigorous.
You are following a method which is more or less scientific discipline, scientific method.
You may or may not employ
a statistical method, but you are still doing something which is a scientific method, empirical method, field studies.
There is a rigor involved.
So nobody would question a political scientist, a sociology student, a psychologist, an anthropologist as being halfway scientist or entirely scientists. So social sciences, which was an American import in India at least, have still a significance. But the other point she's making is an extremely interesting one. As an academic enterprise, they may survive and thrive, but their value in society is being constantly devalued.
Absolutely.
And I think what she is saying is very interesting. You still can have an undergrad degree and get a very good job, but you could also have an undergrad degree in anything and get into civil services and have a very good job. But more and more people would opt for jobs traditionally reserved for a humanities graduate or a postgraduate. They might be a person who's done an MBA in human relations.
Absolutely. In fact, Zoya, you wanted to make a point.
Yes.
Yeah, you wanted to...
Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah, please.
Yes, I wanted to make, I deliberately emphasize humanities and social sciences because you see in India, both humanities and social sciences have been neglected. Whereas in Western universities, there may be problems with regard to humanities, but certainly not with regard to social sciences. Now in India, if we look at the social sciences, economics has flourished. And it's the other disciplines of the social sciences which have been neglected. But I think the most important reason is that both state-funded as well as private universities are principally interested in professional courses, in engineering, in management.
Right.
And therefore, the neglect of social sciences. So it's not only private universities, but I think even state-funded universities do not provide the kind of funds that are required for the development of social science. And if I may say so, there is really no paucity of funds for education in India.
Right.
Over the past two plans, I think in the 11th five-year plan as well as in the 12th five-year plan, there's been a dramatic increase in funding for education. But much of that funding is really going towards professional education and not towards social sciences and humanities. And when social sciences and humanities are taken into account, it is more like an attachment to, let us say, engineering degrees. So, for example, the IITs, the government may support the expansion of humanities in the IITs and the IIMs. But I think that's not enough. We have to focus on social sciences in and of itself and outside of the education for engineering, medicine, and management.
Zoya, my question, which I asked Professor Pant also, do you think that this decline of interest in humanities has coincided with the liberalization and globalization, which is process which has happened in this country or across the world too?
Well, I started that is how I made my very opening remarks. I made that point that the decline of humanities and social sciences or the neglect of it has to do with globalization and the growth of a market economy, which values utilitarian education, where the focus is entirely on what is the use of education, what is the utility of education. Now, that is, of course, important. But that should not be the only concern, and certainly not for public-funded universities.
Yeah, right.
And also, I think we must understand that even if you want to produce good doctors, good engineers, good managers, they must have an understanding of society.
Absolutely.
And this has become so important in recent recent days, when everyone is talking about the lack of moral values, the lack of social values, the lack of social commitment. Now, for that, you need to have a wholesome education.
Absolutely.
And I think that's important even for those who are doing professional courses.
Absolutely. We are joined now by Sitaram Yechury, the CPIM MP, and also somebody who is one of the few thinking politicians we have in this country. Sitaram, welcome. Sitaram, we are discussing about how humanities education has, you know, taken a back seat. You think, you know, you have been an MP, you have observed how governments respond to this. You know, is there a problem in the at the government, at the human resource development ministry level also, about promoting humanities education? Zoya and Professor Pant, who is with me in the studio, both of them think that there is a crisis in humanities education.
There is, of course, and it's very, very unfortunate. And my apologies for being late and joining the show. And you're discussing something very important, which has a very far-reaching implications for the future of our society and our country. You see, I mean, first of all, humanities lay the foundations for a civil society in that sense. And if that is inadequate, then you'll have multiple problems. Like all that we are facing today, the erosion in your moral values, whatever you have. Secondly, humanities education essentially all around the world,
right,
and particularly in all the developed countries, has basically been funded by the state.
Right.
In India, you're seeing the withdrawal of the state from the field of education, and that is having a direct, immediate impact.
Right.
And the growth of private educational institutions is there, I think, only in technical educations. I don't think anybody has forayed into humanities at all.
In fact, Sitaram, in
so
my introduction, in fact, Sitaram,
objective of education.
Sitaram, in fact, in my introduction, I pointed out that there are 113 private universities in the last count in this country, and just a handful of them offer courses in humanities.
Absolutely, and that's exactly what I'm saying. And 20 years ago,
yes,
when my daughter was in school, when she had to make a choice between science and humanities, and she qualified for science, and
right,
she chose humanities,
right,
and my son did subsequently later also, and the principal called me to discuss, is there something wrong at home? We normally have people wanting to move to science from humanities.
Right.
And I said, we never interfere in our children's right to do what they want. I said, what do you mean you don't interfere? The fact that they've chosen humanities in this age itself shows that you have interfered. You know? So it all has to do with a lot of your social moral values and the value systems that you have, which will get seriously undermined if this underrating of humanities happens.
Okay. We are now joined by Professor Sukhdeo, Thorat, former chairman of the University Grants Commission, and I'm sure somebody who has a good perspective on this issue. Professor Thorat, welcome.
Thank you.
Mr. Sitaram Yechury was talking about how the state, you know, humanities education across the world, at least in the Western world, the developed world, and wherever we have seen, the state funds humanities education, and there seems to be a withdrawal of the state in humanities education, funding humanities education. Do you agree with that? Has that happened? Or what do you think is the crisis? We are discussing a crisis in humanities education.
Well, the crisis in humanities and social sciences,
right.
I mean, I would like to put
social
sciences as well as the languages together, is a serious crisis. Mm-hmm. And I think there are two issues here. One issue that we have never had is social science research policy in the country. Either you take any of the report of the UGC Radhakrishna report or Kothari report, there is hardly any perspective that has been developed on as to why do we need social science research, what purpose social science research served. I mean, they say that social science research brings enlightenment. It enables you to understand your socio-political, cultural realities and enable the government to take then policy and several other things.
To build a civil society, as Sitaram actually was saying.
Exactly. And the flowing out of this not having a proper policy is the hugely underfinanced social science research. Indian Council of Social Science Research is the organization which fund research in the university, colleges and the institutions. And you know, the budget of ICSSR was about 36 crore. 36 crore alone. And only of that total, only about 11% goes to the direct research. The rest of them is in other areas.
Okay.
Now, you are 2.5 lakh teachers. Maybe there are 3 lakh teachers in social sciences. And you are required to fund their research, sponsor their conferences and publications. It is extremely less amount. Now, as a result of this, MHRD recognized the importance of this and set up a committee. Mm. MHRD committee for the first time set up a committee to look in the state of affairs of ICSSR. And it was headed by Deepak Nair and Karnik, the member of the planning commission, and Dholkia, who Ahmedabad. And they came with the recommendation. I'm not giving many other recommendation. One recommendation that what social science get is just 2.3% of what the CSIR get.
Okay.
What social science get is only the 11% of what medical science get.
Okay.
Now, as a result, they recommended 21 time increase in the allocation of the social science to the Indian Council of Social Sciences from 36 crore, which comes to 6,500 crore, 21 times. In the beginning, little lower increase and later on, later. Ministry did recommend it, 1,300 crore annually, as against 36 crore only.
Yes.
And I want to share with you, ultimately what ICSSR are getting is only 60 crore per annum.
Not even double.
Ministry had recommended.
Yes.
Now, if that is the state of affair, the ICSSR are able to fund only 20% of the research project that they get, the application, or 20-25% of them who apply for conferences. You know, conferences, traveling internationally, organizing conferences is the academic life of. So as a result, the whole consequences of this neglect of social science is that we are not able to deal with number of social science issues that come up.
No, and is that Professor Zoya Hasan? Is that also another reason? See, you deal with students on a regular basis. When students come for admissions, what is their is it one of their last priorities, or maybe in places like JNU it's different, but I'm sure in the universities, in the normal universities, in state universities, this problem must be happening regularly.
If we look at universities as a whole, surely humanities and social sciences is not the first priority of a lot of students. But it is not as though there is a shortage of numbers of students coming for these subjects. But it's just that humanities and social sciences is their second choice. Their first choice are professional courses. And within social sciences, their first priority would be economics, and then other disciplines. But I think if I might also make another point, that, and I started by talking of both humanities and social sciences, while we must promote and support social sciences, I think we should not also neglect humanities, because humanities is something different from social sciences. Humanities is about the arts, it's about literature, it's about poetry, and so on. And we really don't have in this country an integrated policy towards the development of humanities. What we have in India is the support for, for languages and cultures associated with languages. So you'll have different institutions which support all of this. But I think in many, many countries, there is a much more integrated policy for the promotion of humanities as well. For example, we do have an Indian Council of Social Science Research.
That's
we have an Indian Council of Philosophical Research.
Yeah.
I would suggest that the government should think in terms of a humanities foundation for the promotion of humanities. And my last point in this connection would be that I think the government in the 12th plan, when it is approving, giving approval to private universities, must insist that all private universities have to have social sciences and humanities
program
in their course structure.
Okay. Sitaram, You think this is something which is in the on the agenda of the government at all? That, you know, bringing humanities, the private universities have been, as Professor Pant was pointing out, is only promoting education which has saleable skills.
Absolutely. No, Mr. Pant is absolutely right.
May I just interrupt you for a second? Let us not conflate social sciences and humanities.
Okay. We will come to that. Yes, Sitaram.
All co-disciplines of education are important.
Right.
Technical, medical, social sciences, humanities. But what we are seeing in our country today, about which all of us are alarmed about, is not merely a devaluation, but a debasement of humanism.
Absolutely.
What this rape incident showed you, what this outrage has been. Now humanism is something that can actually be nurtured and cultivated only through a study of humanities.
Right.
You know, so it's essential, is the bedrock of a civilized nation.
Absolutely.
So it is not counterposing one versus the other, but the fact that you can never underemphasize the study of humanities, and if you want to have a civilized, cultured, and a knowledge society in our country, humanities has to be given the preference and the role that it has to play. And therefore, there is a rethink necessary, and I would entirely agree with Professor Zoya Hasan. The final days of the 12th plan, finalizing of the 12th plan, the Planning Commission must give up its urge and it's some sort of a mantra that it follows of what it calls the PPP in everything, the public-private partnerships.
Right.
And please, for heaven's sake, ensure, as Dr. Thorat said, adequate funding for humanities and social sciences. Okay. Otherwise, what we are doing is a great disservice to the future generations of our country.
Sitaram, how much interest does a regular member of parliament takes in these kind of issues, and how much difficult is it for people like you to push something which you are talking about? As Professor Thorat pointed out, the committee recommends 21 times more funding, and all they get is one time more.
Exactly. I entirely agree with that. And you asked me a question which is which will tickle my soft underbelly. Amitan said it is very difficult to work through these corridors of the parliament on issues like this. But let me tell you, I was very pleasantly surprised when we had the discussion on that international university at Nalanda, that bill.
Yes, yes.
And we had one of the most enlightening discussions and debates in the Rajya Sabha the other day.
Yes.
So there are this silver linings and on otherwise dark clouds, and but with sufficient determination we can push through these things, and I think a collective effort needs to be made. We of course continue to do our bit, but I think the government of the day will have to rise to the occasion.
Okay. I want all of you, Professor Pant first. There is this, Zoya Hasan and Sitaram, both of them talking. Zoya was specifically mentioning about how education in technologies, science education, technology, management education is completely bereft of humanities. Education, as far as courses in humanities are concerned. Do you think time has come where it has to be made compulsory that whether it's a course in, it's an engineering course or course in biosciences or whatever or management, can these courses be made compulsory?
What difference will it make? The IITs started with an integrated course.
Yes.
They have humanities as a compulsory component in their BTech courses.
Right.
But the humanities teaching was teachers were treated as second-class citizens. No student would take them seriously, not even the mathematics teachers, pure mathematics ones, because they thought all that mattered was the tech courses, which would get them grades. And this was an appendage, which like an appendix was best dispensed with before it became solid and so on. I'm not even sure if it's only a question of funding. I think, funding, of course, all of us should say more funding.
Yes.
But look, the argument would always be there that if you are doing research in science, whether in life sciences or physical sciences, that your requirements of money are on a scale, whether you are going
to... It is also, as you said earlier, and as Sitaram himself pointed out, he had his... this personal experience which he had.
At the top level, you have the UGC, you have the ICSSR. I would be very happy to find out what Professor Thorat shares with us the experiences in UGC. The ICSSR is very minuscule funded organization which he heads at the moment.
Right.
But he's also with great distinction headed the UGC, where he had control over, if I may use the word control, over a large number of private and state funded universities.
Yes,
and where humanities were.
Professor Thorat,
When we take UGC and social sciences together, and the funding that goes to social science and humanities, still it's very, very low.
How does the UGC treat this whole issue? Has UGC ever done any serious
funding of research is on the low priority of the UGC. That is
not just funding.
The standards in higher education, including
encouraging more and more people to take up humanities course.
I think, as has been pointed out, that we have developed this perspective that the engineering and the medical should have a social science component. They do have a social science component, but it turned out to be a mechanical thing.
Though
you are required to take one or two courses in social science, so you do take those courses and finish your formality. What is required? The social science component of technology, social science component of medical science.
Absolutely.
The interface, the interdisciplinarity, so that the students are able to understand.
Has any work been done on that? Is there any effort being put into blend this?
There has been an attempt on the part of the UGC to encourage as much as possible the interdisciplinary courses, the multidisciplinary courses.
Absolutely.
In fact, UGC has a number of programs. For example, gender studies is get neglected in the mainstream social sciences. So they develop a program promoting gender studies, Women Research Center. Then our own thinker in India, epoch-making thinkers tend to get ignored. So they set up a program of epoch-making thinkers. So UGC does take care and induce the universities.
Professor Zoya, quickly, your point is very well taken, saying that, private universities, there should be, the government should, have a compulsory thing as far as private universities are concerned. Any other suggestion as far as blending and this multidisciplinary approach or interdisciplinary approach which Thorat is talking about?
Well, there are two things. One is the question of funding. There is absolutely no doubt that in the 12th plan there should be a very, very significant increase in funding for social sciences and humanities. Secondly, I think beyond funding, there's also the question of the orientation of the social sciences. We as social scientists have to also think about the kind of social science we want to develop, because what has happened in India over the past few years is that there's so much focus on policy studies and identity politics.
Right.
These are the two areas that we are focused on, and that I think is also in a way undermining the development and flowering and flourishing of social sciences. And my third point I just want to reiterate, and that is that private universities must be asked to develop social sciences and humanities in their curriculum.
Okay. Sitaram, last words to you quickly. Humanity, how does the political class, you think the political class has a responsibility to ensure that this crisis is resolved or at least arrested to some extent?
Of course. The main responsibility lies in the political class, because it is the, I don't like the term political class, but anyway, it is the parliament and the politicians which finally make policy.
Right.
So the policy has to be made a proper policy where there will be adequate funding. I'll just take half a minute. Where there will be adequate funding. And I think a great deal of thought has to be gone in. The time has come for a proper integrated course structure and syllabus in the country.
Okay.
And not enough thought has been put. The days of multidisciplinary approach are over.
Right.
We have now reached a stage of transdisciplinary approach.
Right.
When a transdisciplinary approach is required, you have to have a holistic view, and therefore a restructuring of your course structures that will have to be undertaken very urgently, and the policymakers and the parliamentarians will have to take the lead in making these policy changes.
Okay, thank you. Whatever all the four very eminent panelists which I have today have made very, very significant points, but there's also one point which is very important. which some of them have also made, is about changing the mindset of the society itself about courses in arts and humanities. We know how people respond when their children decide to take up arts courses, as Sitaram was pointing out, what the teacher's response to it. The general society's response to these things also is quite dismal. Anyway, we hope these things will improve over a period of time. Thanks. I hope this debate will ensure further debate about these issues in the country. Thanks to all my guests, Sitaram Yechury, Professor Zoya Hasan, Professor Sukhdeo Thorat, Professor Pushpesh Pant. Please keep watching. We'll come back with another issue on The Big Picture, same time tomorrow.